my biggest thing I have to do for people is what I've come to call marketing therapy. Like, you will not believe how many calls end with, I give you permission. And they don't need my permission, but it just helps that somebody gave them that permission other than themselves. Like, you don't, like I say, you have permission to not do a newsletter if you hate it. You have permission to charge more if you're worth more, you know? And authors, like, their eyes light up. Like, I've told them something life changing. I've done nothing. but so many of us, we're holding back and we don't really know why until somebody points it out and says, it's okay, let go.
Welcome to the Author Like a Boss podcast, the podcast for indie authors who want to improve their writing, up-level their marketing, make money with their books, and have fun doing it. Now, onto the show with your host, Ella Barnard.
Hey, bosses. I had so much fun in this interview with Molly Fitz. We talked about engaging your readers and working the algorithms and doing all that while being your weird, authentic self and having fun. So if you'd like to learn how to become an empowered six-figure indie author while being true to yourself, your stories, and your fans, come to the free Author Like a Boss Masterclass. You can sign up at authorlikeaboss.com/ALAB Masterclass. Hello, everybody. Hello, author bosses. We are here today with my dear friend, Molly Fitz. Now, while USA Today bestselling author Molly Fitz can't technically talk to animals, she and her doggy best friend, Sky Princess, have deep and very animated conversations as they navigate their days. Add to that five more dogs, a snarky feline, comedian husband, and diva daughter, and you can pretty much imagine how life looks at Casa de Fitz. Writing her quirky, cozy animal mysteries is pretty much a dream come true, but sometimes she also goes by the name Melissa Storm, who's also a USA Today bestselling author. And under that name, she writes a very different kind of story. Thank you so much for being here, Molly.
Thank you for having me. This is my first interview where I get to be full on Molly, so I'm excited.
Yeah, I know. I'm like, I'm just going to say Molly just because I'm excited by it. Excited by it. Okay, so tell us, everybody, so you know, I have interviewed Melissa before as Melissa. So, and she's always an amazing interview. So you should definitely go check it out. But today we're talking about Molly. And so I wanted to ask you a little bit, if you could tell us about yourself and your author journey.
Yes. Well, I wrote my first book when I was like 24, 25. And that was a women's fiction novel. And then I published a bunch of stuff in YA and kids books. And did okay, but then I became a mom and it changed completely what I wanted to do. So after taking some time off for health reasons, I came back as Melissa Storm, and I started writing inspirational and sweet romance as well as women's fiction. Again, a return to that. And that was all going great. Made USA Today bestsellers list a couple of times. Really like what I write. Developed a readership. But then December 28th, 2018 happened. And I know the exact date because of my PayPal transaction history. a client I was working on her ads with her, she had to be out of the office. So she introduced me to her cover designer to get the images I need. And whenever I meet a new cover designer, I like fangirl over them because I love cover porn, essentially.
Oh my gosh.
So I went and checked out her pre-made and I said, it was Lou Harper, Cover Affairs. And I said, oh my gosh, your covers are so cute. There are several I want to buy. I'm so tempted, but I don't write cozy mysteries. And then 2 hours later, I bought five of them. And I said, I write cozy mysteries now, and my name will be Molly Fitz. And here's the website I just spent the last 2 hours building. Thank you very much. It happened really fast. Like the covers, they just, you know, great art inspires.
Oh my gosh. So true.
I get inspired by covers all the time, and I've based whole stories around them. In this case, I've based a whole persona, and, you know, they had cats and dogs, and they were just so cute, and I'm such a crazy animal lady already, that they just really struck a chord with me. I've written mysteries and suspense into my romances, so... Yeah. So I already enjoyed reading the genre. So I did more research and just said, this is great, because while my romances tend to be tearjerkers, they're very like deep and touching, and there's real growth and it really gets you in the feels. My mysteries just let me bring out my freak flag, wave it in your face and do a funny dance, blow a raspberry. I mean, I am so weird. I never get to be weird enough in my romances. So when I became Molly Fitz, it was just full permission to celebrate that weirdness. And whenever I think I've taken it too far, readers like it even better. So it's like now the challenge, how weird can this go?
Okay. So. I have so many questions about that. But first, so now, when did you first publish your... as Molly Fitz?
April 30th is when I published Kitty Confidential. I put it up for pre-order at the end of January, and started running a couple ads to it just to kind of get a feel, since I wanted to make sure I could sell the book. And it just went gangbusters. Like, it just started doing so well. And even when I turned off the ads, Amazon kept selling it for me because I hit that algorithm. It's like the dream everybody wants.
Yes. Even with it on pre-order?
Yeah. No, wow. Going crazy. So then I was like, okay. So I put up the next three for pre-order a month apart, and I put them all at 99 cents, releasing wide on, you know, all retailers, and then decided to put them in KU the week after release, Kindle Unlimited. And the first three hit the USA Today bestsellers list, and I spent less on hitting the list with those three books, so three times, than I did once for Melissa Storm. And I was like, wow, I am onto something here. Like, this is really working. And I saw my income go higher and higher. and I was getting just like really random fan mail. That's really fun. Because usually my Melissa Storm fan mail, I really like connecting with readers, but I get sad because I write about sad things. So my readers write to me about sad things. But with Molly Fitz, it's like, look at this picture of my cat. Look at this picture of my dog. And I love that. So, yeah, I'm really enjoying being Molly Fitz. I'm working on book 5 in my Pet Whisperer PI series right now. And I have 5 new series planned. So a lot of great things happening.
Oh my gosh. I am so happy for you. And I already have bunches of questions written down. Because I'm like, but my first one, like, we'll dive into the USA Today, yada, yada, ads, that stuff right now. But first, because it really struck a note with me when you said about, you know, I am so weird, because weird is the thing that I was like, that's the exact word that I was called when I was younger, not in the nice way. Like, you are so weird. And so I'm every time I hear weird, and now I've owned it, right? I'm like, yeah, I'm weird. Like, happy weird. You know? But I'm really curious about, so I love how you owned it. And I'm curious about how you are putting your weird into your stories.
Okay. Yeah, I've always been the weird girl too. And, you know, with Melissa Storm and my romances, I've been able to show my vulnerability and talk about, you know, mental health awareness. I'm really excited because I'm writing an own voices story about my obsessive compulsive disorder, for Kensington, and they're going to promote that for me. And I'm really excited to get the word out there. That was the whole Melissa Storm interview you had.
Yep. That's right. You guys, if you want to hear about that, check out that interview. It's amazing.
Yeah. That's all there in that box. The weirdness is just like, you know, we're creative people, readers, writers, artists, and you gotta be weird to create and do something new. And I don't know, I have so much fun doing it. A lot of times I'm laughing when I'm writing Molly Fitz, and I can write those books so fast. When I try to write my Melissa Storm books fast, I get like pretty depressed. Let's be honest, because I deal with topics like cancer and death of a spouse, and it's heavy stuff. Mm-hmm. And writing it fast, it puts me too deep into that world and it troubles me emotionally. But when I'm writing fast as Molly Fitz, I'm just going on a laughing adventure. So some of the weird things are, in the Pet Whisperer PI series, there's a cat and the heroine can talk to him. And she calls him Octocat, and he says his owner's been murdered, but nobody knows it, and he needs her help. So she doesn't know why she can talk to this cat. That's not revealed until book 4, actually, the one that most recently came out. But just what would a cat say? If a spoiled cat had a voice, what would his personality be like? What would he say? What would he do? And I have so much fun figuring that all out. Like, I'm like, okay, cats would be very brand loyal and very particular. They'd be very dramatic and self-obsessed, and they'd say things like this. So one thing he did is this cat only drinks Evian bottled water from a specific teacup. He's very extra. And one of the teacups breaks in book 3. It's very Uh-oh. Sad. Uh-oh. So they end up having a funeral for the teacup. And that was the first instance of, I've gone too far. This is too weird. But readers actually wrote, it was so touching. The funeral for the teacup was so touching. So I'm like, okay, let's go even weirder. So then in the next book, I have the grandma, who's a retired Broadway actress, come into the office wearing a black satin gown and like kind of carrying on like a fancy lady at a ball. Mm-hmm. That wasn't too weird either. So I just keep ramping it up. I also have the grandma wear like the juicy written across her bottom on her sweatpants. And it's just fun is the word. I enjoy it so much. And that seems to get through to readers. And the weirder I make it, the more they like it. So I just keep finding new ways to go a bit crazy.
Yeah. Awesome. Awesome. I love that. Do you feel like there's a difference? Like, I'm curious because I'm imagining, you know, I've talked to other authors where they're like, and then I found the right, you know, like I was a good author before, but somehow I found like a voice that resonated with people. And it was so much easier, like financially, but also fun to write because I was writing what was fun for me. Is that, I'm curious about that for you regarding, you know, yourself as Molly Fitz versus Melissa Storm.
Well, I found that I found that both times.
Okay.
That I really enjoyed writing it. With Melissa Storm, I was trying to ramp up production. And like I said, it was hard because it's dealing with deep issues. There are issues I like to deal with. I feel like the writing is important and I'm proud of what I write. But it's hard to constantly be in that headspace. Mm-hmm. But with the cozies, you know, I'm writing in first person, which also makes a difference versus third person.
Yes.
And I'm following the same characters from book to book. And it's just completely different. It's a lot more fun. Fun again. Fun is the operative word. It's a lot more enjoyable to sit down and be Molly Fitz for a day than it is to sit down and be Melissa Storm. And they're both me. I've had other authors say, well, if it's not really you, how do you talk to readers? And I'm like, well, it is really me. It's just a certain part of me. Both are a part of me. You know, we all have multiple sides. But one is a side you'd want at a party, and one is somebody you'd want to deliver a eulogy at a funeral. They're very different.
I love that. Those are like the symbolism for you and your author personas. Do you take turns between your writing, between Melissa Storm and Molly Fitz?
I have a lot easier time writing Melissa Storm when I'm alternating with the Molly Fitz.
Okay.
But I don't do too many words in the sad direction. Not all of my Melissa Storm stuff is sad. Like right now I'm writing one with a corgi and a fashion designer and a fitness model. Mm-hmm. And there are cute moments, but it's still like body positivity and knowing your worth and finding what you were made to, like, there's still the themes versus mm-hmm. this cat can talk and he wants to know who was murdered and why. It's easier, I guess, to separate myself from anything scary or sad or bad that might happen in my cozies. There's not a lot of that there, but it's so over the top absurd that it doesn't just weigh you down. Mm-hmm. So I like juggling Ideally, I would write one in the morning and one in the afternoon. But generally, my deadlines are as such that that does not happen. I've been rushing to meet deadlines because I'm also transitioning from indie to traditional publishing on my Melissa Storm side, mm-hmm. which I found is a really good fit for me there and gets me writing at about the speed I want to write for Melissa Storm. And I can fill the rest of my days with Molly. So that's a huge transition for me.
Yeah, I was talking, you know, casually with Elise Kova. No big deal. Whatever. Sorry. No, but when I interviewed her, she liked to have like some in traditional, some in indie, because she's like multiple streams of income. That way, you know, multiple places that it's coming from. How is that process working for you? Like, is it, I'm really curious about, because you've done everything in the indie. Like, you're like so pro. You're such a pro indie.
I'm laughing at you, but thank you.
Yeah, I know. Well, yes. Okay. Whatever. We can talk about all the things that you're doing, but all the things that you told me right before we started recording, but we don't have to, because everybody, you can just go look her up and see how amazing she is. But how is that process going? Like, did they contact you? Did somebody contact you? And then I'm really curious about this writing at the pace that you want to write at. What does that mean exactly?
Ooh.
Like, how is that happening?
Okay. So I signed 3 books and a novella with Kensington. They're who I'm with. Mm-hmm. And I met them last year at the RWA, Romance Writers of America convention, which was in Denver last year. Mm-hmm. And there's an industry marketplace where everybody's hanging out to talk to authors. And I didn't have any particular reason to go, but there was a lady with a dog, and she had a little dog in her little chest carrier like a baby. And I was missing my dog so much. So, you know, my dog is in my bio. I love this little dog. I have 6, but Sky Princess is the ultimate. And I was really missing her. So I ended up deciding to be best friends with the person who had a dog, because I hadn't seen a dog for days. I was going through withdrawals. And so we talked, and I said, yes, I love dogs. I have dogs in my books. Look at my website. And she was the marketing head for Kensington. So wow. It was like, hey, Melissa, so awesome. Like, she told me, like, email this editor, copy me. And she's like, Melissa, so awesome. You have to see this, and you have to see this. And she told me this. And this marketer, Vita, she just went to bat for me. And so the editor was like, hey, I picked up 2 of your books and I really liked them. Let's do a call. We want something new. So then we came up with an idea together, and within 10 minutes, I wrote 1 page about it, and they offered me a deal for 3 books. And they're putting me in an anthology with Fern Michaels, who is,
oh my gosh,
like the queen of my sweet genre.
Yes.
And the prequel to the series. And so far I've been so impressed. Like, the book isn't even coming out for close to a year, and they've already sold some ancillary rights, like large print. There's some really exciting things going on the marketing level, because my original friend is my marketer now. So they're coming up with all these really cool opportunities that I'm not allowed to share yet until they're announced in a press release. But, you know, when I first decided to look into trad publishing, a lot of my friends were like, why? You know how to run ads, you know, branding, you sell as indie. What can they do for you that you can't do for yourself? And so far they've done a lot. I'm learning a lot. I'm getting a ton of really big marketing opportunities. And I realize that my experience is not typical, because I've been made front list, and a lot of author, you know, mid-list authors don't get that opportunity for that big star treatment. For whatever reason, they gave it to me, and it's been just incredible. And I'm so humbled and honored to be partnered with Kensington, to the point where I'm transitioning to just focusing on my trad side for Melissa Storm. That's how much I like it, that I'm willing to go all in for that pen name.
Wow. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Congratulations. I can imagine turning some of those, because it's not like you still couldn't whip up a pen name whenever you wanted.
Yes.
And go indie.
In theory, I could do, yes.
You know, like, not like you have time to do that, but I mean, like,
they didn't give me a non-compete clause, so I can still indie publish all at once.
Yes.
It's something has to give eventually. Like, I can't.
Oh my gosh.
It's too hard maintaining 2 indie pen names and 1 trad pen name. Mm-hmm. So that's why I was like, well, let's slow down production here, mm-hmm. a little.
so happy for you. I think that's amazing. Okay. Yeah. So I have so many questions, but the reason we set up this interview was to talk about how you went from zero people knowing about Molly Fitz to being like, wow, people really love this, and getting lots of money on pre-orders apparently. And and I just want to say, like, I just want to acknowledge that I'm certain the amazing cover artists, like the cover art, like people are like, that's adorable. I'm literally looking at it right now. I'm like, that is adorable. No wonder you bought them. And no wonder people were loving them and buying them. But can you tell us how you went? Because you didn't, if I remember correctly, you didn't like go to your Melissa Storm people and be like, hey, and now I'm writing as Molly Fitz and bring everybody over. Is that correct?
I mean, I did a little bit of that, mm-hmm. but I'm trying to keep them mostly separate. Definitely people know I'm both.
Yes.
Originally, I had Melissa Storm writing as Molly Fitz because I had my letters, USA Today bestselling for Melissa Storm and not yet Molly Fitz, because no book was out. Mm-hmm. Once the first book hit the list, I took Melissa Storm off because I realized that by doing that, it really crippled my Melissa Storm income because it tangled up my also bots. So I separated them back out. And, you know, I hit Facebook ads and Bookbub ads, you know, pretty hard in the start. Like 50 to 100 a day for the first couple weeks. And that gave it the juice it needed to just keep running. I had never seen that before where you could completely turn off the ads and it's still just ranking so high. Mm-hmm. 'Cause I think I got as high as like 402 in the pre-order stage on Amazon. And I had, I think by the time book one came out, I had almost 9,000 pre-orders for the series.
Wow.
So, you know, and I spent a total of 8,000 on book one, but that was also promoting the whole series. And that was for a solid 3 months. And that's not bad considering how many I sold and how well the series continues to sell and earn me each day. Mm-hmm. So definitely coming out swinging was important. I realized from this that if you're going to put a pre-order up, you need to market it. A lot of authors think that you put a pre-order up so that they can auto buy the next book. So you do every 3 months. And that's what I used to do too. But if you put a pre-order up and you don't do anything to promote it or share it, Amazon sees that it's there and no one's buying it. And that's going to hurt you before you even launch, because they're going to be like, okay, people aren't interested in this book. Versus you put a pre-order up and it sells, 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 sells. They continue to promote this series for me. Like, I really, like, it's incredible.
Yeah. And
I compared it to my next Melissa Storm pre-order, which had like 300. And then I look and my Molly Fitz's get 2,500 plus.
Wow.
So it makes a big difference.
Okay. Okay. So I'm really curious about this making ads for pre-orders. Now, I can't remember. Did you say you were doing Amazon ads for the pre-orders or Facebook ads for the pre-orders?
Facebook and Bookbub.
Okay, Facebook and Bookbub for pre-order. And you had it set for when did you put it up for pre-order?
Late January, and okay. It launched April 28th, okay. 30th, April 30th.
So you had it up for pre-order for a few months, like the length of the time that you can put it up for pre-order, like 90 days or something like that?
Close to it, yeah.
Yeah, almost. And you were running ads the whole time?
Not the whole time. I shut them off for a full month.
Okay. Okay. And you don't have to, I know you're doing a course for Facebook ads, so we don't have to talk about it, but just what do you think, you said something in here about running ads just to the first book or running ads to the series. What do you mean by running ads to the series?
The series page.
Okay.
And more recently a box set of the first three together. So when I first started, I started with Facebook ads and I used the cover art just exactly as is, no extra design. The artist gave me the print wrap with no text. So I just cropped it into a square and that was my ad image. And that works really well because it's already really good art and it creates a consistent experience for the reader who clicks on the ad and then sees the same art on the sales page. Mm-hmm. And I started with my first blurb I wrote, which was in third person. Then I'm like, well, what if I wrote it in first person? And I started an ad to test that, and bingo, that worked better. So I was like, okay. So then I made some changes and kept testing until I got the one that was getting me the best clicks and best conversions. Mm-hmm. And yeah, the rest is history. Like, it was just finding who to target with that. Like, on Bookbub, I used Molly Fitz to really learn how to, the ins and outs of Bookbub ads. And cozy mysteries in the Bookbub space aren't as difficult or competitive to run ads for as romances.
So
easier to find and build on success there.
Okay. Are you willing to talk about that a little bit? The Bookbub ads?
Sure. And yes, you mentioned I do a Facebook course. I also have a Bookbub course, and I also have a writing and marketing cozy mystery course.
What?
That's the one I'm teaching right now, is the cozy course.
Dude, I feel like we haven't touched base for a couple of months, and like your life is entirely different.
Yeah, the same. But yeah, Bookbub ads, you know, a lot of authors give up on them really fast because it's easy to look like your money is just evaporating into cyberspace. But it really pays to spend more time learning and understanding. With the Bookbub ads, you're going to want to target only one author at a time, and you want to make sure that they have between 5,000 and 50,000 readers. Smaller, you're not going to get served. Bigger, it's not going to be a good cost. And the other important thing to remember about Bookbub ads is that you should be willing to spend more per click because the conversion is so much higher. If you have a 99-cent book in a newsletter all about 99-cent books, you're more likely that when they click, they're going to buy, versus from Facebook, they're like, what's this? It's not going to convert as high.
Because it's going in an email. Versus just sitting on a computer screen.
Specifically to book readers. Like, you can best to get book readers. And for certain retailers on Facebook, there are ways to target that, but it's not guaranteed. With Bookbub, if you're serving an Amazon US link, it's going to an Amazon US reader.
And who has subscribed to Bookbub and who has said that they like your genre of book.
Yep.
Like, it's really, they've done a lot of the filtering for you at Bookbub. Like, they're more likely you're reaching your ideal customer more easily because they've already self-selected as being Bookbub newsletter followers.
Well, and you can target anybody, basically. Versus Facebook, there are some really limited options because not everybody's targetable. But I will say, on both platforms, but especially for Bookbub, make sure your cover art is harmonized with who you're targeting. Even if you've read so-and-so's books and they feel a lot like your books and you'd have the same readers, if the cover art is drastically different, it's not going to convert. So for me, I was looking at, you know, cartoon-based covers and ones with animals on them. If I saw something with, you know, a witch, that's not going to convert as well for my cover with a cat. So I was looking for other authors with covers with cats or a similar looking art style. And that's who converts. No matter how much I think my writing is like Angie Fox, for example, I don't. She's my hero. But no matter how much I, in theory, think my writing is like hers, our cover art styles don't match up. So she's not going to be a good target for me.
Can you talk a little bit about that, the cover art styles? Because I've talked to people and there's like a real like, I want to be original kind of feeling sometimes. Even with people who've been doing it for a little while, there's still like this sentimentality for their first book cover. You know what I mean? Like, there's like, but it's so good, but it might not still be a match. I know people that are updating their covers. You know, I saw KF Breen updated her covers for Born in Fire, and she's huge. And she'd presumably been doing pretty well. And then she updated the covers again. And I don't know when they first came out, but like, can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah. Even if something's selling really well now, it's not necessarily going to sell really well in 2 years. So a lot of the pros do regularly update their cover art. And the best argument I've heard for this is, oh, I can't change, you know, people say, I can't change the covers because my readers love and are really attached to these covers. Those are readers you already have. You want new readers? Guess what? Changing your cover is going to help accomplish that. Now, for Molly Fitz, I'm nowhere near needing to change my covers.
No.
But, you know, if the trends change drastically and people don't like cartoon styles anymore for cozies and everybody's going photorealistic or everybody needs to have the main sleuth on the cover, It's something I might have to do one day. Mm-hmm. And I love my covers, and I know they go a long way to selling the books, but that's just the way the business is. Yeah. I would go to the same artist because I adore her.
They're really cute covers.
Good artists, they study those trends and changes, and they know of them. So if I have a problem, I can talk to my cover designer. Hey, what would you suggest for this? So yeah, and the cover designer's Lou Harper, Cover Affairs. She has a Facebook group. She posts pre-mades. I like, if there's ever a cat on them, I try to be the first one so I can buy them. Like, there's a cat and it's by Lou. I am buying it. So yesterday I just scored 5 new cat and freak shake covers.
Okay, I am so, after this interview, going to go check that out. And I think what's hilarious is that as soon as we start talking about cats or animals, one of my cats like jumps on the desk. So like earlier when you were like talking about your dog, my one cat walked, you know, across right behind my microphone and fell asleep in the cat bed on my desk. And then just now the other cat jumped up. And I'm like, they know.
They sent me. I'm one of them.
Yes. Yes. I want to ask you a little bit about having animals in your stories and how that helps or doesn't help, or how you use that if you do at all in your marketing. Because I read this book by Skye McKinnon, who she was going to do an interview with me. And then she got really busy with deadlines and whatnot. And I was like, fine, I get it. But she had written this book. It was like the most brilliant thing, where it's I think it's a urban fantasy kind of suspense. I don't know what genre it is, but it's a woman who can talk to cats. Okay. And the cats help her solve mysteries, kind of like yours, but not, I think, cozy mystery. I think heavier on the romance than on the, anyways, she was like, I have all these cats in the book. And so she went to her audience and asked all the audience to describe their cats and their names. Like, she went to her readers and then like put their cats into the book because this woman could talk to all the cats. And I was like, that is so brilliant, because you know cat lovers love their cats.
Yeah, it's a huge part of my marketing. Yeah, it's a huge part of the story. But even with Melissa Storm, you know, a lot of dogs. A lot of mm-hmm. dogs in my Melissa Storm books, and lots of cats and other animals in my Molly Fitz, but specifically this one cat. And my lead magnet, when people sign up for my Molly Fitz newsletter, a lot of authors will send out a free book or a free short story. I send out pictures of my cat. I just put together a collage of pictures of my cat. And on my site, if you go there, it says sign up and you'll get new release updates, blah, blah, blah. And also you'll get to see pictures of my cat, and people love that. I get so many more thank yous and responses about the pictures of the cat than the actual free books I send out for my other names. I'm like, maybe I need to send pictures of my dogs for Melissa Storm and stop giving away free books.
Wow. You know, this is, oh gosh, I'm so sappy today, you guys. It's ridiculous. But like, I'm almost getting teary eyed, because what I really, really love is people being able to be like their truest self and have other people respond to it. That's why it was so hard when I was called weird when I was younger. I mean, everybody has things. No, teenagers aren't very nice. But like, I've, you know, spent my life trying to be my truest self and hope that people will respond well, because it's so scary. And that's why I love helping writers, because I'm like, do it, put your true self out there in your books and let's get people to respond. But it sounds like you can go be your quirky self and people love it. And I love that.
Like, I think we're all to an extent trying to appear presentable to our peers, to the greater world. For whatever reason, we want people to like us, and we think to make that happen, we have to be normal or normal enough. And I found that we're all hiding weirdness. You know, some people have no problem letting their true self show, but most of us are hiding our weirdness to some degree. In my bio, it says I talk to my dog all day. I really, truly do that. And I'm not going to start in my interview, oh, Sky Princess, who's mommy's best babe? Like, but I do that all day. And I keep it out of the interview until just now.
Oops.
But, you know, a lot of us do that, especially animal people. We talk to our animals. We plan crazy things. I had a 4-day birthday party for my Chihuahua. She got bacon wrapped filet mignon, which my husband specially prepared for her. People sent in gifts. We had a party. We took her to a restaurant to celebrate her birthday.
Oh my gosh.
These things really happened. I really did these things recently, last week. And by the way, you should say, happy second birthday, Sky Princess.
Happy second birthday, Sky Princess.
She really appreciates it. But I was posting about this and I'm like, wow, I really have the best friends because I have close to 5,000 Facebook friends and I didn't get one rude comment with all these posts about celebrating my dog's birthday to a very extra extent. Mm-hmm. It's like I found my tribe.
Yeah,
but I think we all have that to certain degrees. Like maybe you're not as crazy as I am when it comes to celebrating your pets, but yeah, you talk to your cats throughout the day and you know, you know their personalities and interests and quirks, and usually that's stuff you don't talk about in a professional space, but why not?
Fewer
people talk about these things and own these things, it's more refreshing when somebody does. So in I came as Molly Fitz to share my weirdness and extreme love of animals. And people identify with that also because it's an introvert trait. A lot of the times when I didn't have friends, I had my pets. And a lot of avid readers are the same and have gone through that. So, you know, books and dogs and cats, those are the things.
Yeah. Okay. Our conversations tend to do this because we have a lot of similar concerns about stuff like this, but whatever. Because like my husband and I just got back from a 4-day weekend away and I made sure to tell each of my animals, I'm like, okay, you guys, we're going to go on vacation. I'm like, we're going on vacation because I saw a show somewhere, like a psychic animal show, where they were like, the animals are upset because you didn't tell them that you were going to go away. And so now every time I'm like, we're going away for a few days, but we'll be back.
Girl, we're going to Australia and New Zealand, my husband and my daughter, my 5-year-old daughter, for close to a month, all of August, basically. Mm-hmm.
Oh my gosh.
And my brother, who lives with us and works for me, he's going to stay and take care of the animals. But I made it very clear. I said, I'm going to FaceTime with Sky Princess once per day. And at the same time, every day you have to play our song. Our song is Unchained Melody. So I'm like, and I'm going to listen to it at the same time so we can be listening together.
Yes.
I'm going to be gone. So Unchained Melody is their song because I've been dreading for a year almost that I have to leave her for a month. And even though I know she'll be well taken care of, I'm giving him Sky Princess lessons. And like, she needs to sleep on a pillow in this position. These are the times she likes to do the things. Like, and even though he's been living with us for a year and he knows all this, he still needs special lessons.
Yes. I made a list for the people who are, I'm like, here's the list. It's like, it could be very long, but we're only gone for three full days. But I think I also think you're right. Like I was very lonely for a long time. Like I was single for a long time. And there's something about coming home to your pets. They're so understanding. They love you even through your weirdness.
They're always there and you never have to worry about them judging you. Like they're the ones who embolden the weirdness. And Sky Princess, I call her my emotional support Chihuahua. Like, you know, if I'm sad, she sees it and she'll come over and comfort me. She'll cuddle me. She's just always there. When I work, she and her mom, Mila, they both sleep in baskets on my desk. They're right next to me right now. And then when we relax in the evening, they're both on my lap. And then when we go to bed, they're both cuddled up against me. So they're just always there. They're my constants.
Yeah. I want to talk a little bit about, I'm going to take the segue of weirdness and animals and segue into sharing that weirdness, because you said that people, you know, we have this idea that we want to be present ourselves as normal, but I think, especially as you get older, like we don't have to remain in our teenage mindset our whole life, thank God. As we get older, we appreciate more people who are confident in the parts of themselves that are not quote unquote normal. You know, I think part of me, I've read this somewhere where they're like, people don't read books to see the normal. People read books because in the books, the characters get to say the things that you always wanted to say, but never did.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, so many of my reviews say, I wish I could talk to my cat. Like almost every single one says that.
Yeah. And so I think, tell me what you think about this. The people finding their writing voice, to me, almost in a different way, is like giving yourself permission to be who you really wanted to be. Is that?
Oh, for sure. Like, you know, I offer author services and coaching as well. And
yes,
my biggest thing I have to do for people is what I've come to call marketing therapy. Like, you will not believe how many calls end with, I give you permission. And they don't need my permission, but it just helps that somebody gave them that permission other than themselves. Like, you don't, like I say, you have permission to not do a newsletter if you hate it. You have permission to charge more if you're worth more, you know? And authors, like, their eyes light up. Like, I've told them something life-changing. I've done nothing. but so many of us, we're holding back and we don't really know why until somebody points it out and says, it's okay, let go. So I like to do that for authors.
Me too.
Yes, I know you do.
Me too. I love talking to people like you who also are saying the same thing. Like, and I think it's great that I love the author space, especially indies, but I haven't spent that much time in the traditional author space, so I'm not judging. I just don't know. But I love the space where one person's success means more people succeed. Like, the more people buying your indie cozy mysteries, the more people buy yours, the more people will buy all indie cozy mysteries, you know, with
that's what I believe too. And when I first put up the page for my course, my cozy mystery course, it's huge. Like, there's a ton of stuff in it. There's a writing unit with 10 videos, and then there's a marketing unit that's going to be like 15 videos. So we're talking at least 15 hours of content, if not more, and for $99. And when I put that up, some cozy authors in the space said, this is awful. You're making a cash grab. And I'm like, excuse you, I can make a lot more money billing hourly and teaching people individually. Mm-hmm. Like, I want to help the genre I love. And they're like, you're going to flood the market and there won't be space for us real authors. And I'm like, okay, bye.
Wow.
You again. Not because they were criticizing me, but to say you're going to cut us real authors out and flood the market. Like, no, there really is space for everyone. And I've always had an abundance mindset, and I want to see if people are interested in this genre. I want to help them learn about it and decide if it's a good fit for them so they can do a good job.
Yeah.
That's the opposite of flooding the market. I'm not saying get rich quick writing cozy mysteries.
No. And bad cozy mysteries by indie authors are not going to help anybody.
Yeah. So yeah. I definitely, like you said, I have an abundance mindset. I think if somebody reads Kitty Confidential and it's their first cozy, they can say, I really liked that. What other authors might I like? And that's definitely happened for me. I mentioned that Angie Fox is kind of my hero. Mm-hmm. She's the first cozy mystery author I ever read. And I fell so in love with her words and her world. And I'm still such a huge fan. And she created this spark in me that I didn't know was there. But I totally credit with her for turning me on to the genre and this life that I just love and fits me so perfectly.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
And people, here's the thing, like, people read more than one book. Like, it's not like the one book that somebody buys from you is going to be the only book that they read. People read more than one book. I read, according to Kindle Unlimited last year, which was quite a while ago at this point, we're in July now, but last year in 2018, I read 363 books on my Kindle.
Yeah, we read.
That's counting rereads. That's not counting physical books that I own. That's not that's just the Kindle books, which granted was the majority of them. But like, I read more than a book a day, basically.
I read over 100 last year.
Yeah.
So you've got to eat, but certain genres.
Well, I'm not as busy as you.
Certain genres have what you call the whale readers, who will just come and gobble up a whole series, or readers who, like you, read a book a day, and mystery is one of them. Yes. Mystery and romance, those readers are hungry.
Yes.
There aren't too many of us. You know, like you said, what I would hate is somebody who reads a really bad one and says, oh, I'm going to put the genre aside for a while and maybe never come back to it.
Yeah. Yeah, I'd rather have somebody putting them out and be good. Like, these are good with the right covers, with the right. And you're like, these are my fellow people. Oh, that's so interesting. I've run across that a little bit as well, that kind of scarcity mindset. And I think part of it comes from, like, when the industry, people who've been in the industry for a while, like who started in 2011 or 2013. Not everybody, because I know you started a while back as well. But some people where it was a lot easier because there weren't as many authors. So they were like, it was so much easier to make money back then. And they expect that that's how it will be.
And I hate that so much. Like, I almost decided to pull the course because of the bullying. And I'm not used to people criticizing me. Usually I get a lot of praise for the types of things I do. And people like me and like my services and like my courses. So I was just shocked by this. Mm-hmm. And I said, it's not worth it. I'm really upset. I'm crying. I don't want to do this. And a couple of friends, but also people I didn't even know, saw this and said, what you're doing is really cool. Don't let them get you down.
Mm.
And I went ahead with it. And, you know, the people in it have really enjoyed it. And I've gotten a lot out of doing it. And I think that's so important too, is the people with the abundance mindset. Don't be scared away. Don't, you know, you have a permission to be weird and be yourself, but also you have permission to keep going. If you're doing something that you believe in, that you truly think can help people or make you happy, do it. You're not, if you're not hurting anybody, especially, do it.
Right.
So I'm really glad that I went ahead with it, even though I was so close to not. It's been good.
I'm so glad you did too. And I'm sure there's lots of people listening who are like, a cozy mystery course. From somebody who went on the USA Today bestseller with her first cozy mystery, 9,000 pre-orders.
Three.
What?
Did three in a row.
Yeah. Okay. So yes, not to missay. Let's communicate clearly. Okay.
There's abundance here.
Molly really is a badass. Okay. You distracted me. Shoot. Okay. So
I consider myself boss.
You have a cozy mystery course so that people can go find out how to do that. Why don't you just tell people where they can find that real quick?
YourAuthorEngine.com.
Okay.
And I have a number of courses there, and each one is just $99, even though there's a lot of content in there. So.
Okay. Yeah. Because she's more about the abundance.
I am.
And dude, every time, you know, when, here's my mindset about,
I was going to cry again.
I know. I'm like, here's my thing about anybody who's telling somebody that they shouldn't be helping other people learn to, you know, be successful writers. I think about every time I look at it, like the 100 best fantasy authors of all time, or the 100 best classics of all time, or whatever they are, the lists, right? And I'm very pro female. So they're always like 80 to 90% dudes. And, you know, they try to, you can tell whoever's making the list is trying to put some women in, maybe a person of color, maybe not, you know, they try to throw something else in, but really it's mostly all dude authors. And I think about how many people were writing back then. Like, it wasn't just dudes that were writing stuff. It's not like there weren't women writers. Even, you know, 30 years ago, there was women writers, even 40, you know, like even 20 years ago, not that long, people were writing their stories and somebody was saying, this isn't good enough or this won't sell or whatever it is. Right. And what I love about the indie space is that, you know, if you can find your people, you can sell it. And there's a lot more people like a much broader, you know, more varied kind of weirdness than we all thought.
So,
people like our weirdness. Every time I get an email about my podcast, I'm like, really? But I'm so dorky.
Okay. Not a robot, not a cardboard cutout, which I feel like too many of us try to be in life.
Yeah.
You know, as a creator, create something new, different. Put your own twist on things.
Yeah. How do you put your own twist onto these things so quickly? How are you writing so fast, Molly?
My brain never shuts off.
Okay.
I have OCD, so when I get an idea, I think about it a lot. Even when I'm not thinking about it, I'm thinking about it. I call that letting the story marinate. And yeah, I don't know. I'm very deadline driven. I'm very goal driven. I'm very word count driven. So I do consider, like I said in the other interview we did, that anxiety is fuel. Learn how to harness it and steer it. You know, it's not necessarily a bad thing. You can worry or you can get it done. And I choose to get it done.
So you, because I'm fascinated, I'm sure I'm not the only one, you bought the book covers in December, the end of the year, December 28th.
Yes.
And then you put them up for pre-order, put the one up for pre-order at the end of January.
Yep.
Had you like thought of a story in the interim, like during that month?
A little bit. Yeah. Cause I had to write the blurb.
Okay.
So I knew enough to write the blurb.
And when did you put up the other ones for pre-order? Like at the same time, or did you see the good response and put more up for pre-order?
I saw the good response. Okay. And a couple weeks later, I put book two up, and yeah.
For a month after that, correct? For a month after the first one came out.
I released one a month. They're 40,000 words, so they're not super long. Okay. It's actually not that hard to write that much, especially if you're in a flow.
Yeah, and especially if you're having fun, I imagine. Oh, yes. Oh, I had one more question for you around that from a while back. So we're circling around to the beginning of the interview, you guys, real quick.
I do need to give you a warning that we have about 5 minutes before my husband returns home with our daughter from summer camp and the garage door opens.
Okay.
And our dogs are for 10 minutes straight.
Okay. We'll skip that last question then.
Okay. You won't hear what happens.
About it a little bit. I guess my comment is this, like I've found in my life, and I'm curious about you, and you can say yes or no, is when I first started doing, you know, creative work, I was doing creative work that was helping me heal my own issues. And now as I'm healing or healed, I like doing things that instead of like getting up to neutral space, like I was down and now I'm up to neutral. And from neutral, I like to see like, well, what do I want to create now that I'm okay? And I'm curious about it, that if there's any similarity for you in that with your writing under Melissa Storm and writing under Molly Fitz.
I've never thought about it like that, but possibly.
Okay.
It's a very interesting take.
Yeah. Okay. I was just curious.
I'm interesting and I shine light and spread awareness wherever
I go. Yeah. Which doesn't mean that you have to stop the other one once you get to neutral, but it's like an interest. Anyways, for me, I'm like, oh, this is what I did. This is what I'm doing. It's so interesting because I am interesting. Just kidding. Okay. What is your best advice for people who want to be successful authors?
Listen to the Author Like a Boss podcast.
Oh. Especially the Melissa Storm or the Molly Fitz interview. Duh.
Yeah. I mean, that goes without saying. But my best advice is to find what you love and do it unapologetically. Full stop. Because too many authors chase trends with genres, chase the latest marketing technique that everybody's doing. No, you know, be authentic, find something that you really connect with, that you really enjoy doing, that you would maybe even do, even if it wasn't popular. And therein lies your success.
Okay. Look, this is like the third time you made me cry on this call. Gosh, dang it. Okay.
I'm going to start bottling your tears and using them to cast spells. I do have a paranormal spinoff coming, a paranormal cozy spinoff. Ooh. So Ellie Tears might make an appearance.
Oh, if you do, you have to do another interview. Okay. Where is the best place for people to find you?
For Molly Fitz, I have a site, mollymysteries.com.
Okay.
All my Molly Fitz stuff.
and your authorengine.com for the Cozy Mystery courses, including the Facebook ad course and the Bookbub ads course.
You can look me up on Facebook. I'm in many places.
Yes, she is all over.
But look my name, you'll find a bunch of stuff.
And we'll put some links in the show notes for this episode. Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you, Ella. Have a good night.
Thank you. And thank you, everybody, for listening. Hugs and happy authoring here at Author Like a Boss. Hey, bosses. If finding your ideal reader, engaging with them, and then turning them into superfans is one of the challenges that's keeping you from making six figures as an indie author, then you'll definitely want to come to the next Author Like a Boss Masterclass, where you'll learn exactly what you need to do to become an empowered six-figure indie author. You can sign up for the free masterclass at authorlikeaboss.com/ALAB masterclass.
If you love the Author Like a Boss podcast, we'd love for you to subscribe, rate, and give a review on iTunes. Until next time.